Good morning. First of all, to thank for the invitation, the organizing and scientific committee. It's a great honor to be here. In my talk, I would like to focus on the prostate cancer treatment from radiation oncologist perspective. I work as a radiation oncologist in Poznań, the city located in the west part of our country, in the halfway between Berlin and Warsaw, our capital, and about 140 kilometers far from Petersburg. The Greater Poland Cancer Center belongs to one of the biggest centers in Poland. Here you can see the my department, radiotherapy department, where I work. In the Greater Poland Cancer Center, we have actually six standard classical accelerator with imaging on board. And on the top of this slide, you can see some special accelerators would we have. The first one on the left is a robotic accelerator called CyberKnife. On the right, we have tomotherapy. So we started in reality our journey with prostate cancer treatment with radiotherapy from 1996. Why not before? Because we had only access to 2D, two-dimensional radiotherapy, so it's a weak tool for treatment of this cancer of patient. So what has changed in the last 20 years in our community? I would like to focus on the epidemiology, radiotherapy improvement in technology, and what we collect, the evidence base, and also the changing approach to decision making process, epidemiology of prostate cancer. As all we know, prostate cancer is one of the most significantly frequently diagnosed cancer in men. One quarter of all cancer diagnosed in men is prostate cancer. So it's number one on the top. The second, the lung cancer, on the second place, it's constitute for European Union is the data from GloboCan 2012, about 14%. On the third place, colorectal cancer, altogether about 13%. So you can see that is a huge problem and will be in the future a huge problem. What about the incidence rate? Poland is located in the lower part, so the incidence rate is quite low. It's very similar to Russian Federation. If you compare to Germany, Austria, United Kingdom, Czech Republic, so you can see that there's a quite huge difference between incidence rate in Poland for prostate cancer and this country. So my speculation is that probably in the near future, we will rather come to this level, incidence rate, so it means that total number of patients diagnosed with prostate cancer increased. What could happen in the near 10 years? In 2015, we diagnosed in Poland about 13,000 new cases with prostate cancer. So the extrapolation, the expectation for about 10 years, it could be 22,000. So it could be almost double the number. If we take into account Greater Poland region where I live, where we provide our radiotherapy care, so in 1965, we diagnosed almost 900 patients with cancer, with prostate cancer. In 1990, it was about 2,000, double. In 2010, almost 4,000, double from this date. And expectation for 2025, it could be even 8,000. So it could be a tsunami of cancer, prostate cancer in Poland, but not only in Poland, in other countries where the incidence rate is quite low. Prostate cancer patients, if we look at, we are aging as a population, and we meet and we will meet in a daily practice of older patient, but what is interesting that even for 70, 75, or 80, even 80 age men, when the health status is defined as excellent or very good or even average, so you can expect 18, 14, 11 years life. So it could be a candidate for radical treatment, especially with high risk or intermediate risk stage of disease. So radiotherapy could be a perfect tool, perfect method of treatment for such patients. Yes, it could be a huge group of patients. Also what happened during the last decade, stage of disease, some kind of migration of stage of disease from high risk group in the red bar to the low risk, intermediate is rather stable. So now we meet in daily practice more patients in low and intermediate risk group. So for this group of patients, the quality of life and then overall survival is the most important factor. For the high-risk group, of course, overall survival is on the top of our aim, and then quality of life. So what we can expect? Here we can have an abstract from the journal Radiotherapy and Oncology of the leading journal in Europe from 2016. The authors evaluate the utilization of different methods of treatment for prostate cancer. You can see that external beam radiotherapy, calling my lecture, my talk as a radiotherapy, it could be used for almost 60% of all treated patients with prostate cancer. On the second position is radical prostatectomy. On the third, brachytherapy, only about 10%. So it's a huge difference between the utilization, okay, based on the evidence-based guidelines and population of patients. And also how many new cancer patients in Europe will require radiotherapy by 2025, with publication from the same journal from February 2016. Among the different tumor sites, the highest expected relative increase by 2025 in treatment causes was prostate cancer by 24%, on the second lymphoma, then head and neck 12%, and breast cancer about 10%. So you can see that prostate cancer for radiation oncologist community will be a very interesting field and will be probably the treatment number will increase in the near future, taking together epidemiology, aging of population, and also possible method of treatment. So technology and dose. With dose, technology is very close related, and how important is dose? So radiation effect is all we know. Here we have an elegant experiment which clearly show that we have a small tumor prior irradiation, then we irradiate in the tumor to 33 grade, then 42 grade, 54 grade, and below you can see a graph representation dose relationship between dose and effect, tumor control probability. So you can see that for these doses, even quite large, there are no oncological effect because we leave some cancer cells and we can expect recurrence for sure. But from some point of dose, you can expect increase and very steep increase in dose efficacy. So it's for us very important dose escalation during, especially in this range of dose. So many decades prior, 1996 in Poland, but not only in Poland, I suppose that in many other centers, we use a very small doses, around 60 grade, with this old-fashioned technique, 2D technique. So why we use such doses? Imagine the tumor, prostate as a tumor, as a target, 4 centimeter in diameter, and at 5 centimeter margin around the tumor. So you receive about half a liter of irradiated volume on unnecessary normal tissue. So you produce a very high toxicity level. So in this is why we lower the doses. How important is precision irradiation therapy? On this simple example, you can see a tumor once again about 4 centimeter, and if you add 9 centimeter around the tumor, you receive the radiated volume to the target dose, 102 cc. If you decrease this margin, you can decrease also very dramatically, very significantly, the dose around which you receive our target. Here in the clinical example, what happened when we try to irradiate with dose only 70 gray. Nowadays, 70 gray for radiotherapy of prostate is not acceptable dose, is suboptimal dose. And for 2D techniques, 55% of the rectum, the most important organ at risk, receive 55 gray, unacceptable from toxicity point of view. For 3D techniques, 1/3 of the prescribed dose to the target receive 30 gray, 30% of the 70 gray. Unacceptable, maybe in some cases could be, but with very high level of toxicity. IMRT technique could lower this dose to 18%. So you on this slide, you can see example of improvement of toxicity level when we use IMRT technique. Is data from Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, published in Journal of Urology 2001. This IMRT technique was started in the United States in 1996. So you can see for 3D technique, 81 gray toxicity level in rectal, grade 2, it's about 15%. But if you use IMRT technique, you can lower this to below 5%. So it's a significant decrease. But not only for decrease of toxicity we use a modern technique, but especially for increase the dose level to the prostate. So here you can see some examples of randomized clinical trial, which clearly show that dose increasing in prostate results in better biochemical control. It's translate probably in overall survival benefit, but we have such data. What is the obstacle for radiotherapy, for precise radiotherapy in prostate cancer? One of the most is the movement of our target. Prostate is a moving target. It's not a stable. In a different direction, even rotation, so it's a huge problem in our clinical daily practice. We can distinguish interfraction movement. Well, for example, conditions of patient, of target location could be different than in particular treatment days, treatment sessions, or even between treatment sessions. So in such situation, here you can see the prostate and the red cycle around the prostate. The dose is okay, it's correct. But if the prostate changes the position, so we have a situation where some volume of the prostate is outside the high dose, so we miss something of dose. And we know that dose is one of the most important factors, so we can, in this situation, decrease the treatment results. Here is the intrafraction movement, even more significant errors which could occur during the radiation. When we have a presence of gas in the rectum, this gas pushes the prostate up. Yes, it's a standard situation during one session or at the beginning of session. And what happened? You can see the high dose, once again, and inside the red cycle, and some part of prostate is outside of the high dose. But unfortunately, some volume of the rectum, the most significant organ that's at risk, in the high dose region. So you can expect that target is under irradiated, but the rectum receive too much dose. So you can expect higher toxicity with the price of lower efficacy. Here we can see some very good examples from clinical data from MD Anderson Cancer Center and from Dutch trial, which clearly show how important is this issue for undistended rectum. And distended, you can see the difference in biochemical control is the same for the Dutch trial. Even if you use a very high dose. You miss this some part of the dose. So it's strongly important to use something what we call image-guided radiotherapy. IMRT plus image-guided radiotherapy, it should be a standard of care. Here, an example of such influence of image-guided radiotherapy plus IMRT. Blue bars, toxicity in the rectum. As you can see, 80% versus 13%, 60 for bladder, 60% versus 11%, the huge difference. So now it's we are a little bit moving to something what we call hypofractionation. We use a higher dose of fractionation, which allows to, first of all, reduce the treatment time. So it could be more convenient for our patient or also for us, maybe less expensive or maybe better result therapy. What we need, more precise radiation therapy. Here you can see comparison, the standard IMRT technique with IGRT for regular radiotherapy, and the red is prostate, and around this we add additional safety margin. And in case for prostate cancer, this margin is significantly reduced. This allowed to use a higher doses. Yes, once again, the CyberKnife. And what's happened with the results? Here you can see some data published in Radiotherapy and Oncology from the American group. And for low-risk group, the PSA relapse-free survival in 5 years terms, it's 95%. So it's a very, very good result. For intermediate risk, 84%. For high risk, 81%. So it's very interesting. What about the quality of life? Because I mentioned that quality of life is one of the most important factors which we try to evaluate for radical prostatectomy, external beam, and brachytherapy. Could be even better than for external beam standard and external beam or brachytherapy. But we don't have any randomized clinical trial which compare head-to-head this method. So it's only based on experience, even prospective, but not randomized data. Also comparison for quality of life in CyberKnife with surgery. Also, it means that it could be that CyberKnife quality of life patients is better than for surgery. Here you can see a final slide on the session which was held in during the ASTRO conference in 2014 in San Francisco on the quality of life in prostate cancer. I mean, it's quite funny, but on the top you can see the quality of life after prostate SBRT, stereotactic body radiation therapy. And guys play golf, and quality of life after surgery, brachy or proton. So they probably looking for the ball in the bush. Evolution of radiation technique, which happened in our center. As I mentioned, we started with 3D conformal radiotherapy with doses 70 grays, so we can could expect about 70% biochemical disease-free survival. If we change to IMRT with IGRT technique, which the dose is close to 80 gray, so we can expect biochemical results above 80%. And then we move to CyberKnife. We treated so far about 400 patients, so it's quite a large group. And what about what we collect in terms of evidence-based medicine? Generally, we are disappointed because when we look in different locations, different tumors, we we see that we have a lack of evidence. We know very well the pyramid of evidence. On the top of this pyramid is randomized clinical trial and meta-analysis, and on the bottom, internet advertising, or my last case. So what we have during the last two decades? We know that for low dose, intermediate, and high risk, dose escalation is a very important factor which improves the treatment results. And we have such data. But you know, we only evaluate the dose 70 versus 78. No, we don't have any data for larger, for higher doses, so we need such clinical trial. Also, we have a data which compare radical prostatectomy to active surveillance. We know that radical active treatment, radical prostatectomy, give a survival advantage. Not huge, but it's significantly, statistically significant. Also, we know that for intermediate and high-risk group, combined treatment, radiotherapy plus androgen deprivation therapy, translate into, in comparison to radiotherapy alone, translate into survival benefit. Also, we know that adding radiotherapy to androgen deprivation therapy is better than androgen deprivation therapy for high-risk group and very high-risk group. But we lack a randomized clinical trial for low-risk intense comparison, the most important treatment method as radiotherapy, radical prostatectomy, radiotherapy versus brachytherapy or versus protons. There are ongoing some clinical trials which compare radiotherapy to protons in the United States. In Europe, I don't know exactly, maybe they are starting something like this. Also, we don't know what could happen if we add high dose to androgen deprivation therapy. And also, we don't know which method is better, radiotherapy or radical prostatectomy from head-to-head randomized clinical trial. Why do we combine hormone therapy with radiotherapy, the most frequent combined treatment in prostate cancer? ADT causes remodeling of tumor vasculature, so play a role as an anti-angiogenic factor. ADT also reduces hypoxia in tumor, very important factor. ADT reduces double-strand breaks repair and also kills cancer cells. So its combined treatment could be as an additive synergistic effect. Also, combined treatment could reduce the side effects of radiotherapy and enables, in some cases, to perform radiotherapy in very large prostate gland. And so what is important, there are no overlapping toxicities for both treatment. Here you can see some example how could neoadjuvant androgen deprivation therapy decrease the side effects. It's a dose which receive rectum and bladder prior neoadjuvant androgen deprivation therapy, and after such treatment, we can see significant reduction in dose in rectum and bladder to both organ at risk. And what about intermediate risk prostate cancer? Here we have a very old but landmark clinical trial from United States, RTOG 9404. This number, it means that this year when this trial was started, so it's a very old, for only 4 months adding of an ADT to radiation therapy, we can expect survival benefit in 5%. It's not maybe a huge number, but if you compare to gain from postoperative radiotherapy for breast cancer, it's the same level. It's about 5%. So it's significant. So the standard of care is radiotherapy plus minus. Why minus? It's not added here in the slide. 4 to 6 months, because we don't not have data for high dose radiotherapy. Maybe high dose is enough. Yes, in such case. So it depends on clinical situation. For high risk prostate cancer patients, as you know, it's a related to local high-risk local relapse, high-risk lymph node mets, distant mets, and also radio resistance. So we have a large body of evidence for this group of patients. First of them group is comparing radiotherapy plus nothing, it means without androgen deprivation therapy versus short-term. A very old clinical trial with clearly showed that for high-risk group, overall survival was significantly improved when we use combined treatment, and about 10-15%, and depends on the clinical stage and how long we use the hormone therapy. Once again, another from Harvard University trial, from Australia trial, and another group of trial which compare short androgen deprivation therapy with long term. Once again, we can see overall survival, the most important endpoint in clinical trials. For 5 years, for 76 versus 71 for radiotherapy alone. But if for 10 years, you can see that the difference is bigger. It's 47 for combined treatment versus 38 for radiotherapy alone. So also from Europe, ERTC trial, very known, 16% improvement in overall survival when we use combined treatment for high risk. So number needed to treat is very low. It's 5 only for this group. Also, we check if it could be possible to use a short-term androgen deprivation therapy, 6 months versus 36 months. It should be added that longer androgen deprivation therapy is better. Here is a very interesting update, very old clinical trial, RTOG-9202. Which compare 4 months androgen deprivation therapy with radiotherapy versus 28 months. And we can see that after very long follow-up, 20 years, we still see a quite large separation of survival curves between combined treatment, long, versus short. So it means that this treatment works for many years, 20 years, not only for 5 years, 2 years, yes? And what about role of radiotherapy when we combine with androgen deprivation? Maybe we don't need radiotherapy. So we have some clinical trials from Scandinavia, which clearly show that adding radiotherapy significantly improve overall survival. Number needed to treat is 10, so it's quite large. Also from UK and Canada, we have another trial published in Lancet 2011. It's stated the same. So according to guidelines in European Urological Association, in patients with locally advanced prostate cancer who are fit enough to receive radiotherapy, the recommended treatment is radiotherapy plus long-term ADT, and the use ADT alone is inappropriate. Yes, so it's a very important message to us, but also to urologists, yes, that should such patient refer to us, to radiation oncologists for combined treatment. What about situation when we have metastatic disease in lymph nodes? We also know, but not from randomized clinical trial, that combined treatment is better than adjuvant hormonal therapy alone after radical prostatectomy and lymphadenectomy. It's the same data from United States. So we should combine this treatment. And what about high dose? We have some very important clinical trial presented in 2014, 2015, which clearly shows that for high-risk group, adding combined treatment, ADT plus radiation therapy improves the overall survival. So still this combined treatment is a very attractive method. And what about postoperative radiotherapy? We have a free randomized clinical trial, but only one of them from United States WOC trial clearly shows that such treatment, postoperative treatment, should translate into overall survival. But all other three showed that it could improve, that improve biochemical free survival. So when do we need start or consider start the postoperative radiotherapy after radical prostatectomy? As early as possible. So you can see that when we have a patient with PSA below 0.5 and then in this subgroup, so you can see the huge difference in progression of disease. So we should start and convince urologists to refer us patient after radical prostatectomy to earlier treatment. Here we can even say that maybe this limit level of PSA 0.2 nanogram per ml, it should be too high. Maybe we should refer patient, urologists of course should refer patient earlier to us. Also, what about androgen deprivation therapy combined with radiotherapy for salvage radiation therapy when we have a PSA recurrence? We have some data from RTOG-9601 clinical trial which showed that such combined treatment with anti-androgen, it's not LH, RH agents for 24 months, such combined treatment transfer translate into overall survival. But we need to wait for other clinical trials which are ongoing for final result evaluation this topic. So in conclusion, long-term androgen deprivation therapy combined with radiotherapy for high-risk prostate cancer improve overall survival, co-specific and distant metastatic-free survival. Even in the area of dose escalation, patients deriving the greatest benefits from such treatment are patients who are in the greatest risk of distant metastasis. And for intermediate risk and high risk, we know that it's a heterogeneous group, so maybe we need some additional tools which should divide these groups into subgroups. And what about decision-making programs? What happened during the last decades? Now we decide about treatment in multidisciplinary team, MDT, because we have in prostate cancer radical prostatectomy, radiotherapy, combined treatment, how and when to start. And unfortunately, we don't have a randomized clinical trial. We can meet a lot of papers in our journal that radiotherapy is better. We can, on the other hand, can see that surgery is better. So we should discuss and also should include some expectations of our patient about toxicity. As I mentioned, quality of life and toxicity are very important factors. So urinary incontinence, erectile dysfunction, bowel urgency are most very important factors. We are waiting still for the final results of very important for us trial, PACE trial, which in study A compare radical prostatectomy with robotic assisted to SBRT with CyberKnife. And the study B is SBRT versus IMRT technique. So probably in 2025, the results will be published. So it's very important for us this date. Also very important, even called the trial of the century, PROTEC UK trial, which compares surgery, radical prostatectomy to radiotherapy too. So both results should be very impressive for our communities, how to treat maybe what is the best method of treatment. And the role of MRI, not only in diagnosis, prior treatment, but during the radiotherapy, it could be important tool for dose escalation, for something what we call dominant intraprostatic lesion. Is the probably, we don't know for sure, that could be the most aggressive part of the tumor. So maybe we should add additional dose in this subvolume without excessive toxicity, yes, but because it is a very important factor. And only a few words about oligometastatic disease. It's a very interesting topic. Introduced into clinical practice by Hellmans and Weisselbaum in 1995 and describe situation when patient has distant disease in a limited number of regions, less than five. Five is a limit. And the primary lesion can be controlled, removed, or controlled. Yes? So why is so important for prostate cancer patient? You can see we divided as disease for localized, locally advanced, very locally advanced, and metastatic. Now, probably we should divide metastatic disease into subgroups. This M1 oligometastatic versus or and then polymetastatic or diffuse disease. You can see the difference in survival curves in case of polymetastatic disease versus oligometastatic versus polymetastatic. So maybe we have a situation that in stage of oligometastatic disease, when we could stop, cure the patient even in this stage, we can prevent go the patient to the polymetastatic disease. So it's a very interesting topic. In 2012, in New England Journal of Medicine, we had a publication which described a patient, a woman with melanoma on the skin after surgery, then occur metastatic disease. The patient was treated with ipilimumab, you know, immunotherapy, new agent, received some response on the treatment, but unfortunately, there occur a little pain and the pain worse, and patient was referred to palliative treatment with SBRT on this lesion and very close to the spine. And what occurred after such treatment, other distant metastasis disappear. So we call it as abscopal response. So it's a huge debate now, what is the role of radiotherapy in this oligometastatic situation? Yes, probably radiotherapy increases the antigen presentation and activates also dendritic cells. Dead of cancer cells caused by radiation release these antigens. Here we can see preclinical evidence from such trial, combined trial, anti-CTL4 plus radiation therapy to control, so we can see difference. And in 2014, in the United States, started a large randomized clinical trial which compare anti-CTLA-4 plus radiotherapy versus placebo for patients with metastatic disease, bone metastasis, up to 5 mets, it's according to definition of oligometastatic disease, with dose of 8 gray. And then the patients who are treated ipilimumab versus placebo. It's standard of care is not ipilimumab for prostate cancer. It's and the another clinical trial, yes, which for M1 patients with metastatic disease randomized to supportive care, the best supportive care, plus radiation therapy or maybe surgery when could be possible, versus supportive care, the best supportive care. Another from United States trial once again, but here in the situation when we have a patient, new patients with distant metastasis. So the patients are irradiated to prostate, not for distance. Also very interesting, it's from Europe Stampede trial, one of the arms randomized patients with M1. Newly diagnosed patient with metastatic disease to ADT only, the standard of care, versus ADT plus radiotherapy to prostate. What is important? Diagnosis, the level of diagnosis, sensitivity, specificity. You can see if you are truly try to define oligometastatic disease, you should implement the best imaging as we can have on the board, so you can see the difference. The same patient, yes, but we can see the huge difference in a number of metastatic disease which could be revealed. So, oligometastatic disease is defined by new technology, and without very good imaging, oligometastatic disease doesn't exist. So, if you need to go further, you need to have better diagnostic tools. So oligometastases are not a full systemic, probably, metastatic disease. Oligometastases can be treated to prevent systemic progression, to go to next phase of cancer stage of disease. And aggressive, even aggressive treatment can give an excellent and durable responses. And the final conclusion for my presentation on the future of radiotherapy, first of all, technology, tracking target and adapting treatment in real time, thanks to better soft tissue imaging, introducing MRI into the imaging evaluation, the prostate evaluation and normal tissue around prostate, and calculating capability. On the biology terms, the focal radiotherapy of more aggressive cancer as a boost dose, or maybe a focal radiation therapy as an alternative to the entire radical treatment could be a solution. Also, improvement and better knowledge of prognostic and predictive tests, which allow personalized radiotherapy. And once again, combined therapy, combined with new class hormone agents. We have a new, very interesting hormones, which are on the market. Also, immunotherapies could be another step, which give better results. Thank you for your attention.
Merci beaucoup, cher.